Hello and welcome to Insights IS. This course is designed to make your prelims preparation so much easier, streamlined and comprehensive. Let's begin with the first issue, that is ATG India Index by NITI Aayog. Guys, Sustainable Development Goal was introduced in 2015 by United Nations General Assembly. So in this light, NITI Aayog has released the second edition of the Sustainable Development Goals India Index, that is SDG Index 2.0. The index documents the progress made by India's states and UTs towards achieving the 2030 SDG targets. The index spans 16 out of 17 SDGs, which marks an improvement over the 2018 index, which covered only 13 goals. The SDG India Index has been developed in collaboration with the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation, the United Nations and the Global Green Growth Institute. This statement is very, very important from prelims point of view. The year 2020 will be 5th anniversary of the adoption of SDGs by 193 countries at the UNGA. A composite score for SDG Index 2019 was computed in the range of in between 0 to 100 for each state or union territory based on its aggregate performance across 16 SDGs. The higher the score of a state or UT, the closer it is towards achieving the 2030 national targets. State or UTs are classified based on the SDG India Index score as follows. First is based on aspirant, then performer, then front runner, then achiever. India's composite score improved from 57 in 2018 to 60 in 2019-20 with major success in water and sanitation, power and industry. However, nutrition and gender equality continue to be problem areas for India, requiring a more focused approach from the government. The ranks of 14 states have dropped in the index compared to 2018. All states and union territories except for Delhi have scored above 65. Let's move to the states, and Kerala has the top rank with a score of 70, followed by Himachal Pradesh with 69 ranks. Bihar has emerged as the worst performer with the lowest score of 50. UP has shown maximum improvement, followed by Odisha and Sikkim. In case of Union Territories, Chandigarh has topped the list with a score of 70, followed by Puducherry with 66. A question in Prelims 2018 was asked pertaining to SDG. Access to affordable, reliable and sustainable and modern energy is the sine qua non to achieve sustainable development goals. Comment on the progress made in India in this regard. Guys, especially mains focus would be given after prelims. So now onwards, we should focus on the points regarding prelims. So this is a goal-wise top state duties. You can have a look on this. And actually goal one, every goal are there, you can have a look on it. So let's move to the next issue, that is Good Governance Index. Guys, Good Governance Day is celebrated in 25th December this year, and 2019, and it was the birth anniversary of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And in this Good Governance Index, launched by Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions to determine the status of governance in the country, it assesses the impact of various interventions taken up by the state governments and UTs. What are those objectives of this Good Governance Index? Provide quantifiable data to compare the state of governance in the states and UTs. Enable states and UTs to formulate and implement suitable strategies for improving governance. Shift to result-oriented approaches and administration. So these things are covered under good governance. Here is your environment, citizen-centric governance, agriculture and allied activities, commerce and industries, human resource development, public health, public infrastructure and utilities, economic governance, social welfare and development, judicial and public security. You can use this flowchart in mains as well. So the states and UTs are provided into three groups: the big states, northeast and hill states, and union territories. Big states are Tamil Nadu, topped the rank in case of big states, and northeast and hill states in that case Himachal Pradesh ranked first. In case of union territories, Puducherry is the best governed UT, followed by Chandigarh and Delhi. Lakshadweep in the worst performing UT. Guys, in comment box, mention in which union territories legislative assemblies are there. So it can be a political question. So let's move to the next issue, that is portal to block and trace stolen mobile. Enable blocking and tracing of stolen or lost mobile phones are very much important. So in that case, it is actually there. The initiative was launched in Mumbai in September 2019 and has been rolled out for Delhi NCR now. It will be extended to other parts of the country in 2020. Guys, in recent times, the mobile stealing is a big issue. So in that case, we should have a proper database to trace the mobile which is stolen. The project is backed up by the Central Equipment Identity Register system, which was undertaken by the Telecom Department for addressing security, theft, and other concerns, including reprogramming of mobile handsets. It will be facilitate request for blocking of stolen or lost mobile phones by customers, allowing services to other existing customers having mobile phones with the same International Mobile Equipment Identity Number. This EMIMEI will be traced upon. Sharing of traceability data with police authorities, as well as unblocking of recovered phones, because data are very much important. Once it is stolen, lots of data can be handed over to a inappropriate person. So let's discuss about International Mobile Equipment Identity, that is IMEI. So this is very, very important. Every phone or mobile broadband devices has this unique 15-digit code that precisely identifies the device. This digit is important. Mobile phone manufacturers assign IMEI numbers to each device based on the ranges allotted to them by the Global System for Mobile Communication Association. Dual SIM phones will have two IMEI numbers. Remember this. This is very important. IMEI number is programmable, and criminals can program the 15-digit unique number, which results in the cloning of IMEI. Consequently, there are multiple phone devices and hundreds of numbers with the same IMEI number. If such IMEI is blocked, a large number of mobile phones stand the risk of being blocked, causing inconvenience of genuine customers. The software that has been developed now allows an individual phone to be blocked even if it is on a cloned IMEI number. Moreover, because of the centralized nature of the register or database, all the operators can block the particular stolen or lost device across the country, even though the phone is being serviced by one particular operator. Let's move to the next issue, that is Poshan Abhiyan. Only 30% of the funds released under the Poshan Abhiyan have been utilized by the state governments and the union territories since it was launched in 2018. What is Poshan Abhiyan? It is the center's flagship program, which aims at improving nutritional outcomes among pregnant women, lactating mothers, and children by reducing the level of stunting, underweight, anemia, and low birth weight by 2022. 50% of the total budget comes from the World Bank or the multilateral development banks, And the rest of the 50% is through center's budgetary support. That does mean it is a central sector scheme. So center's budgetary support is further divided into 60:40 between the center and the states, 90:10 for the northeastern region and the Himalayan states, and 100% for the union territories without legislator. Sorry, I want to correct myself. So it is a central sponsored scheme where the funding is divided between central and state. It is centrally sponsored, and where is the funding is 100% funded by the center or with the assistance of the center, then it is central sector scheme. So here is 90:10 ratio is there, 60:40 ratio is there. So it is centrally sponsored scheme. The Ministry of Health and Welfare released the Comprehensive National Nutritional Survey in October, which showed that 35% of children under the age of 5 are stunted, and in this age group, 17% are wasted, low weight for height, and 33% underweight, low weight for age. Then, Integrated Child Development Services. The scheme provides specific interventions targeted towards the vulnerable groups, includes children below 6 years and women. It is being implemented by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. It provides a package of 6 services, namely supplementary nutrition, preschool non-formal education, nutrition and health education, immunization, health checkup, and referral services. Common application software is intended to use technology for furthering of the objectives of the scheme. So this is actually the map of this total utilization of the scheme, and between 2018 and 2019, Mizoram has utilized the maximum share of funds released under the Poshan Yojana, while Punjab has utilized the last. You can have a look on it. The average utilization in the country is 29.97%. The 3 states which received the most funds between 2017 and 2019 are Maharashtra, UP and Bihar. 32 states and UTs have utilized less than half of the funds released between 2017 and 2019. So let's move to the next issue, that is solar eclipse. And it was on 26th December, and we made it a little bit late because we want to cover it so much comprehensively that prelim aspect question can be tagged upon. So on 26th December 2019, India experienced an annular solar eclipse of 0.97 magnitude with 3 minutes and 39 seconds maximum duration of the totality. Guys, 3 kinds of solar eclipses are there. It was annular solar eclipse. In upcoming slides, we will discuss in details. Parts of Kerala, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu experienced the full glimpse of the ring of fire solar eclipse. The ring of fire is a characteristic of the annular solar eclipse. It causes the sun to look like a ring, that is annulus, and hence that name annular eclipse. Cheruvattur in Kasaragod district of Kerala is one of the 3 places in the world where the solar eclipse was seen most clearly. And the country, guys, in comment box mention in which country the solar eclipse are visible, because I could not remember all those things. Saudi Arabia was one among them, Singapore, India, Oman, these countries were there. You can put in comment box so that you can remember also for a long time. So partial phases of the solar eclipse were visible from all over the country in varying magnitude depending upon the geographical position. What is the main solar eclipse? The main region is known as umbra, where the deep shadow is there. After that, the less shadow region is known as penumbra, and we'll discuss in details. So first we'll discuss what is eclipse magnitude. Eclipse magnitude is the fraction of the sun's diameter which is covered by the moon. It is strictly a ratio of diameters, and it should not be confused with the eclipse obscuration. Obscuration means the blockage, which is a measure of the sun's surface area covered by the moon. Then solar eclipse. A solar eclipse is a phenomenon that occurs when the moon comes in the way of the sun's light. That is, here is your sun and here is your earth. When moon come in between them, this is known as solar eclipse. The moon's shadow cast itself on the earth, blocking out the sun's light. So your moon blocked the sunlight, and here is your umbra is created. After that, the partial light, that is penumbra, is created. This portion is known as umbra region, and the surrounding region is known as penumbra region on the earth. The moon's shadow has two parts, a central region, that is umbra, and an outer region known as penumbra. So this is known as umbra, and this is high shadow, and this low shadow region is known as penumbra, and other parts also known as antumbra, which are very very less shadow or no shadow region. Depending upon which part of the shadow passes over the earth, one of the three types of solar eclipses could be observed. First is your total solar eclipse. The entire central portion of the sun is blocked out by the moon. Then partial solar eclipse. Only part of the sun's surface is blocked out. Then annular solar eclipse. The solar eclipse we experienced on 26th was annular solar eclipse. The sun is covered in such a way that only a small ring-like silver of light is seen from the sun's disk. This ring is also known as ring of fire. So this kind of question can be asked. And an annular eclipse happens when the moon is farthest from the earth. That is, here is your sun, and suppose here is your earth, and suppose the moon would be here. That is known as apogee, when the moon is farthest from the earth. In case suppose sun is here and earth is here and moon would be here, in that case it would be called as perigee. This is apogee, this is perigee. So as the moon is farther away from the earth, it seems smaller and is unable to block the entire view of the sun, because of which the ring-like structure could be observed. When the apogee is there, remember this, the umbra would be less and penumbra would be bigger. And when there is a perigee, the umbra would be bigger and the penumbra would be less. Only remember this, and there are lots of physics behind this, so we won't go in that much details, so because it is not to be asked in UPSC. So the next issue is Drake Passage. It is the body of water between South America's Cape Horn. This is your South America's Cape Horn and the South Shetland Islands of Antarctica. This is your South Shetland Island of Antarctica, and this is your Drake Passage. It connects the southwestern part of Atlantic Ocean, that is Scotia Sea, with the southeastern part of the Pacific Ocean and extends into the Southern Ocean. This is your Scotia Sea, and after that it is your southeastern part of Pacific Ocean, and this is your Atlantic Ocean and Scotia Sea. It is the shortest crossing from Antarctica to any other landmass. There is no significant land anywhere around the world at the latitudes of Drake Passage, which is important to the unimpeded flow of the Antarctic circumpolar current, which carries a huge volume of water through the passage and around Antarctica. The passage is named after Sir Francis Drake, who was the first Englishman to circumvent the globe. So it is very, very important. So let's discuss the question which asked in Prelim 2019. Which of the following statements best describes carbon fertilization? What is carbon fertilization? Let's understand the concept first. The tree takes carbon dioxide and prepares food. When there is a greenhouse gas emission is there, then carbon dioxide is more in the atmosphere. In that case, the intake of carbon dioxide by the plant will be more. This is known as carbon fertilization. Options are: increased plant growth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This is the right answer. And let's read out other options also. Increased temperature of earth due to increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This is the wrong statement. Increased acidity of oceans as a result of increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The wrong option. Adaptation of all living beings on earth to the climate change brought out about by the increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Wrong option. Guys, suppose you are solving a question in prelims, try to also read out other options, because maybe two options may be smaller and similar, and one option may be more appropriate. This kind of question are also asked in UPSC. So reading all options are important. Let's move to the next question, which asked in prelims 2018. What is are the consequence or consequences of a country's becoming the member of the nuclear supplier group? Options are, it will have access to the latest and most efficient nuclear technology. It is the right answer. And second is, it automatically becomes a member of the Treaty of the Non-Proliferation of the Nuclear Weapons. Automatically, no, it is no provision like that, because you have to sign NSG and NPT differently, no relation in between them. So right answer is option A. Let's solve a CSAT question, which is asked in prelims 2019. What is X in the sequence? This, you please solve the question, and after that you can see the answer. So answer will be like this. So suppose you took out the numbers like 4, 196, 16, and after that you make a square of all numbers, then 2 square 14, 4, 12, 6, 10 and 8. So now you can see a pattern. 2, after that 2 plus 2, 4. Then 4 square, after that 4 plus 2, 6 square, then 6 plus 2, 8 square. So in this case, 14 minus 2, 12 square, then 12 minus 2, 10 square. So after that you see, you can see that a pattern is formed. In that case, if you see the pattern, then 10 minus 2, 10 minus 2 would be 8, 8 square would be 64, and answer would be 64. So right answer is 64, that is option B. Thank you guys, have a nice day.